Okay, let's get going. Welcome to the Planning Board meeting for Monday, the 27th of February, 2017. Thank you, HCAM, for recording the meeting today. As you can see, we're missing a couple people. Though we're probably not going to be in a requirement where they have to listen something to, in order to vote on a hearing in the past, but it might be good for them because this is our preparation night for, or one of several preparation nights for town meeting. And tonight we have one key item on the agenda, which is the public hearing for the proposed amendments to the zoning bylaw. Before we get started on that, I'd like to thank the Zoning Advisory Committee for all their hard work on these items. I think I counted them. There's 11 or 12 different zoning, and which is quite a few, but maybe they won't make them all through the list tonight, depending on how it's received by the public and the board. So I'm going to open the public hearing on the proposed zoning amendments to the zoning bylaw. The planning board is required to hold this public hearing on all zoning amendments before they go to town meeting. Eventually, we will take a vote on each one of them in order to recommend it to town meeting, and that vote will be announced at town meeting. What I was thinking today is maybe if it's going really well, and I don't see a huge crowd of angry constituents out here tonight, is that we will vote on each one as we kind of discuss it and go on through it. I think that's the easiest way to do it, so we're kind of discussing things once, and then a lot of these are housekeeping type items. We'll put it to bed there and we'll get along there.
So that's fine, but so just as a reminder, the warrant closes on Wednesday, so if we get closer to the end, we may just want to vote whether or not you want to just submit it and we can work on the language and stuff later.
Right, and there will be two that we'll do for sure that way because they are not a subject to the public hearing tonight because we just came up with them in the last little bit. So anyway, okay, so let's get started with that. The piece of paper that's most important is, at this point, a Zoning Advisory Committee recommendation to the Planning Board, which is kind of a thick thing, and I think there's a whole bunch of them in the back there. So let's start with the first one. We'll do them in order on it. Gross floor area and site plan review. Elaine, do you want to join us up here at the table? Because
I was hoping that Zach Chair would be here.
Well, I was kind of hoping both of you would be here, but that's... So basically, as Elaine has put forth in the Zach memo, basically this was had to do with tightening up the regulations to define what is gross floor area, which is what we use to define whether or not you're subject to site plan review or not. And it has to do with particularly including garages as part of the gross site plan review. And so so basically, do you want to give the Zach recommendation, Elaine?
Yeah, and in the investigation of that, kind of realized that there's gross floor space and gross floor area. Both terms are used, and one is defined, and they're used interchangeably. So we thought that could use some simplifying, go to one term, and close that loophole on site plan review by counting garage space as the trigger to get into site plan review and not exempting garage space. They didn't want to impact the way the definition is currently applied outside site plan review, only to site plan review. And so the recommendation is to go to one term, which is gross floor area, which is more of the industry standard, and define that the same way it's defined today, and then change all the gross floor space references to gross floor area, and in site plan review indicate that the garages do count toward the tally of floor area toward site plan review. And town council is reviewing this. He may have a different way of addressing it, but he understands what I'm getting at.
Yeah. Oh, go ahead, Frank.
Does this affect tax rate for square footage?
No.
It's all the same?
Other questions from members of the planning board? Any questions, comments from the public? This is a public hearing. We encourage participation. And if you've got something that you'd like to say, just raise your hand and we'll get you called on.
That's
and
true. Yes. I do have one question.
Okay.
Here in this case, it's limited just to site plan review. Is there any discussion or would it, any thought about expanding it beyond site plan review? Any impact of doing so?
As far as doing away with the exemption for garages?
Yep.
Zach didn't want to, didn't feel it was necessary to make that change. Yep. Just thought it was more important to do a housekeeping type change than to change the way it's applied. That's not, you know, the board could
right.
decide
I mean,
otherwise. But
I'm more curious than anything. I mean, they didn't want to open up that rabbit's nest.
And they didn't want to make people non-conforming either.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Seeing no further comments on this one, entertain a motion to recommend passage of an article on gross floor area and for and site plan review to the town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion.
Discussion.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, would it follow the recommendations as outlined here by Zach? That would go forward, or is there different language that's going to be proposed?
It would be the Zach language unless town meeting or town council comes up with something significantly different, and we'll get that in time that we'll look at the final wording of everything one more time, probably maybe at the hearing of the last two that are coming down the pike.
Got it.
Yeah.
Well, I think we'll probably, he's reviewing these now, and he's likely to have comments by your next meeting.
Sure.
So I don't know if you wanted, I mean, you could take the votes to submit and then hold off on a recommendation until you see his.
I mean, I don't want to waste any more time with this if we have to, quite frankly. I mean, we're here, we know the subject, and, you know, I don't know. You know, if there's something, if there's a couple little words, maybe, you know, we'll be okay with that. But if there's material, we'll certainly bring it all
sure.
up. Sure. I mean, okay. So I think there's a motion on the table and a second for recommending this to town meeting and putting it on the warrant. I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries unanimously. Okay, the second one we're talking about is the flexible, this is on page two, it's called Flexible Community Development Bylaw. For those people out in the audience, the flexible community development is where we maintain our 10% affordable housing aspect. A developer can either build, I'll say, his requirement as part of his project or potentially with the approval of the town, we will accept cash in lieu of affordable house with the thought that we could then use that cash to build a unit that would meet that requirement at that point. So basically, I believe this was when the developer for the condo project on Hayden Row came forward to paying for his units. Basically, we said that there was the bylaw, it says that you pay for a three-bedroom affordable unit, that's what it's based upon, is his payment. And he says, but that doesn't seem quite fair because I'm only allowed to build two bedrooms in this condo project. So, anyway, Zach, Wayne?
So, Zach felt it needed some clarification since there was this question out there. It's best to resolve it in the bylaw. So, they're clarifying that the payment in lieu is in the amount equal to a three-bedroom affordable dwelling unit, regardless of what's being built in the development itself. So if someone's building five-bedroom homes or if someone's building a two-bedroom condo, the payment is based on the three-bedroom single-family home, which was the intent when the bylaw was originally adopted, and that's what the clarification would say.
So this is very much a kind of a housekeeping. Mm-hmm. Does any members of the board have questions on this?
Well, just a quick question. Why maybe we shouldn't have three-bedroom listed, just have a set figure? Or do we actually, does it vary that figure?
The figure, through the chair, the figure is based on a calculation that the state provides us a method of calculation. So it's based on a four-bedroom household in a three-bedroom single-family home. And it changes a little bit depending on the interest rates and the tax rate and so forth. So it's calculated within, I think, 30 to 45 days of when they're going to make the payment. And it changes based on the area median income. So it does change over time.
It does
time.
Vary. So by law, we do have to put in that it's based on a three-bedroom versus just saying it's based on whatever information we have.
Yeah, we should. We have to really
have to
be as specific as we can without, you know, setting a number.
Any questions from the audience on this one? This is truly one of these housekeeping things that when you're in the regulation business, like the town is, unfortunately, at times, we need to clarify things. And so I'm not seeing anyone from the audience getting all excited about this. It probably applies to about 10 or 12 people in town that are actually developers, and that seems to be where it's at. Okay, I think we're ready for a vote to place it on the warrant and recommend it to town meeting.
Do we need to move it?
We need to move this.
I'll make that.
Frank?
I'll make that motion.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Further discussion?
Just a discussion, but I am totally in favor of this. And a reflection, just because it's a good place to make an editorial comment. In one of the communities that we have that's limited to two bedrooms, I noticed an ad over the weekend that they're selling one of the few three-bedroom units in one of those communities. So a lot of the two-bedroom communities with a bonus room are now being resold as three bedrooms. Not a lot, but at least there's one.
It's not a legal three-bedroom.
It's not a legal three-bedroom, but they're selling it as a... one of
could
the
have an
few.
Issue at some point.
Yeah. So I think it's good to three bedrooms in lieu of one of the dedicated units is a good idea.
Okay.
Discussion point, Mr.
Yeah,
Chairman.
Yeah, go ahead.
The three bedrooms, is that kind of the state registry standard to use for three bedroom determination? Is that what you use in other communities as well?
I think it varies. Each community can decide what's best. I think in Hopkinton, when the bylaw was being developed, they thought that that's what was most likely to be created with the funds that were received, that the town was interested in building single-family affordable rather than multifamily. And so that's kind of how that it was decided at.
Probably that's the need. If there was a need that hasn't been fulfilled in affordable, it would be the probably the threes.
Plenty of fours and fives.
Those aren't terribly affordable. And okay, so let's see, we have a motion on the table
and
a second. So I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstains? Abstain.
Abstain. Late.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, we are now on the bottom of page 2. This is the open space, landscape preservation development, timing of the open space conveyance. This is another kind of housekeeping type item, I would say. Doesn't get too much excitement, but we do have in town for the people in our TV following here, our great hordes of listeners there. I mean, our regular viewers would know this for sure, but open space preservation development conveys usually some open space to the town or to the benefit of the town's residences. And so this open space, this change really just talks about the timing of when the town actually takes credit for it or gets it. And I believe, because right now we really don't have a trigger in there in the bylaw that kind of helps the planning board remember that we need to insist that we get the open space. So it, I think Zach did a pretty good job of writing up a one that says it'll be conveyed prior to the issue of the first building permit unless we grant some extension. So basically, if there's a good reason, we have a lot out to do it. But it, I think there's been a couple of these, particularly not in the last 10 or 12 years, where we've kind of almost forgotten to get the last piece in the open space. There's a couple ones. What? We haven't forgotten.
We have not forgotten any. But okay. It's happened in other places, and Zach was concerned about that.
Okay. So, Elaine, did you want to explain that any better than what I tried to mug it up?
No, I think you covered it accurately. They just wanted to make sure that, you know, they set a point but also allowed some flexibility, and they thought it was an extension with the consent of the entity that was going to receive the land was the important thing, a way to give it some flexibility. Mm-hmm.
Questions from members of the board?
Oh. I did, Mr. Chairman, prior to that gentleman there. The extension of time in such a situation, is there any benefit of potentially defining that extension, 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, in order to ensure or try to make sure that the process is moving?
I'm not sure what Zach had in mind, but basically usually that might be triggered by some work that might be going in and around it, or cleanup or something. I don't know.
Zach didn't have any particular time, but they thought it might involve some construction-related activities for the most part.
And so it's flexible. David?
Will the receiving party be a party and be able to influence the board with respect to the extension time?
I think Zach intended that the board could not grant an extension unless the entity that was going to receive the open space agreed to it. Agreed to the extension.
The time limit on the extension.
Doesn't say that specifically.
That's a good question. Yeah.
That's a good question.
That was my question.
Okay. The other question that I'd like to put in the same similarity of that, it says, or in case of the homeowners association still under the control of the applicant, does that mean that basically the developer would then agree to it? Because eventually it would be the homeowner association, which, you know, before the first building permit, those guys are a minimum of 6 months away from being anywhere near existence. So I
think the intent of that phrase was that a recognition that there might not be a homeowners association to consent, and if there isn't an association yet, then the developer would perform that function.
Okay, I'm not sure it says that.
Yep.
So this might be one where the town council might be encouraged to opine on what the, you know, because I'm 99% sure that the homeowners association would not be in place at that point.
Point of information,
Mr. Chairman? Sure,
go. Elaine, in terms of a conservation restriction on an open space development, is that defined clearly in the OSLPD?
It's in the statute.
Say again?
It's in the statute. So it's in the bylaw, but it's also a statutory requirement.
Okay. But there's no time limit as to when the CR goes on, either statutorily or in the bylaw.
That's true.
Okay. Thank you.
Good question. And it's
yeah,
for
go ahead.
Viewers at home and the audience. When you say it's in the statute, it means state law?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
I have a comment, if I may. I agree with Ken, what he just said. I like the idea of this article, where it gives us flexibility and has a force of a bylaw behind it, but there's some pretzel logic going on here, so I would like more information, feedback. So if we do recommend this, do we have the opportunity to retract it or change it? I mean, obviously we can tweak it, but can we change it substantially if it needs to be?
Well, I think at this point, we'll be giving it to town council, and, you know, his recommendation is I'm hopefully is kind of bounded by a little bit of what we're trying to do here, as opposed to completely rewrite the whole bylaw. He's going to be looking at this paragraph and making sure that it makes sense in context of the rest of the bylaw and what we're trying to do here. But only if the agency concurs with the request. I'm not 100% sure. If they didn't concur with the request, then they wouldn't get the piece. I mean, I guess. So by definition, they almost have to.
I think Zach presumed that at this point, there's already agreement as to who's getting the land.
But
usually you say that, the board says that in its decision, what entity is going to receive the open space. So that's in the board's decision, typically.
Mm-hmm. Does it say we have to put it in the decision?
It doesn't. It's board practice.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, go ahead.
Is there anybody getting a time certain on these? Because in a lot of cases, in a few cases, it has gone till the point of fact that all of the buildable lots have been built out and sold. Virtually so. So time limit is one of my questions.
Well, I think I don't know. I sense, and this is just one out of all the numbers, is to get spun on a case by case basis. I mean, that's. I think I'd keep the flexibility. I don't know.
Okay.
I mean. At the time, I think the developer has the incentive to get it conveyed as quickly as possible because he'll stop paying taxes on it. On the other hand, there isn't an awful lot of taxes on open space per se.
Correct.
So, you know, it's not a huge incentive for a developer, but...
Through you, Mr. Chair. I mean, it does state... The initial normal procedure is before the first building permit. So what we're talking about, right, is just the exception cases, which should be rare and should be flexible,
we are
right?
About the exception case.
Yeah, just yeah. Should be flexible, though, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Yeah, John.
And I think it also states that the entity or agency to whom the open space will be conveyed concurs with the request. I think my issue in putting a timeline in. Is if something has to be done related to that property or access to that property, you want to complete it before it's conveyed. So I think having that flexibility, but again, the entity or agency to whom the open space will be conveyed has to concur with the request. So I think that's the point at which defining limitations, et cetera, may come up.
If I may again,
yeah, go ahead.
So what you're saying is that the entity receiving it has the ability to influence the planning board in setting that deadline?
You have to agree, if I may. Yeah. My reading of it is you would have to agree with the request if you were the receiving.
Right.
Okay.
Now,
I'm happy with that.
I mean, on the other hand, if you didn't agree,
well,
the board could, or the developer could give it to somebody else too. I mean, you know, but that's not any different than what currently exists.
But it has a start point of the first building permit.
It has a start point, and it has a reminder to remind us that we need to make sure we do this. So I think it's got some good stuff to it.
And it would be written into the decision.
Yes.
Okay.
Some of the wording here is like only if, or, well. Only is one thing, and then or is one or the other thing.
Yeah. So we're going to let legal counsel kind of wordsmith that type of stuff. This will be one that hopefully comes back a little bit clearer so that it is. But we know what the intent, I think, is here. So, Dan, any other public comment on this one? Okay. Seeing that, look for a recommendation to place it on the warrant and to recommend it to town meeting.
So moved.
Moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. Okay. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, we are now on to the definition of a restaurant.
Good one.
Lane, why don't you try this one?
Okay. Well, this is something actually that the planning board recommended to Zach, that it look at the defining what a restaurant is. Currently, restaurants are allowed in many districts, and it's not defined. So Zach undertook that, spent several meetings talking about whether they should define different types of restaurants or one definition. They settled on one. One of the reasons why they did that was to cover all of the current restaurants. They didn't want any existing restaurants to become non-conforming and to continue to be allowed in the district in which they are. So they wanted to basically codify current practice of allowing restaurants in all the districts, and they didn't want to define separate types. And also they found that, well, they thought about if they were going to define different types like a takeout or a sit-down restaurant, that then the town would have to decide which types are appropriate in which district. And we only have a couple of commercial districts. And so they felt that when they thought about it, they would end up allowing all of the types in all of the districts. So why distinguish between them? And when they were looking at it, they realized that they needed to change the parking requirement a little bit too. So along with this is the definition, changing it by name in various districts, and then upping the parking requirement for districts. It gets increased because now we would count employees and we would count outdoor seating.
Okay. Questions from members of the board?
Just curious, how does this affect restaurants who have no lot, people park on the street?
The off-street parking bylaw already exists, and so in order to go into a location, they have to meet a parking requirement. They can have it come to the board for a special permit to park off-site, to share parking, and those kinds of things. So there's options for applicants if they're in that situation, say downtown.
And when we define parking in a spot where there's multiple businesses that obviously share the parking, how do we define what spaces belong to the restaurant versus what will belong to the rest? Is there a specific?
The bylaw currently says it's cumulative based on all the uses. However, if people believe that the shared parking will be at different times of the day and so forth, they can go to the planning board for a special permit to allow that. So it comes back to the board to share. And so it to not be cumulative, it has to come back to this board. So that's already in the off-street parking section.
Further questions from the board? Because I have one, I'll go last here. Okay, I go to the definition of restaurant on the top of page 4. It's a retail food establishment, a food service establishment whose principal business is the preparation and sale of food and or beverages, whether for consumption on or off premises, and which includes counter or table services. Is there a restaurant type that doesn't have a counter or a table service? And I was trying to think of one. I'm not sure.
I think the point is that it's different than, say, one of the other two places in the same neighborhood that are gas station / convenience stores that sell food and coffee or snacks that are hot. Those aren't restaurants, those are...
I think they are.
Like a Cumberland Farms type of thing? Is that what you're...
Right, that's more and then
accessory. Yeah, so Zach didn't think that those would qualify as restaurants.
Okay, so
they would or would
they would not.
Which includes counter or table service, so...
Service. So some kind of service.
Those, yeah.
Okay, so basically you're saying Cumberland Farms isn't a restaurant because even though they will serve you lunch on a takeout basis.
Well, it's available, but there's no service.
What's the definition of a counter? And some things you do need cooked for you in Cumberland Farms, for instance, or in
Subway. Well, it's self-service. It's not a service provided by the establishment. So no one heats it up.
You get certain foods.
Subway is a restaurant without customer seats.
Right.
But it's Cumberland Farms would be a restaurant without customer seats, I guess, in that respect. You know, really, what they're serving is an accessory to their business. It's not really, that's not their business.
Okay, I was just trying to think of making sure that we had the definition loopholed. But
Zach, they threw out a bunch of different types of, you know, including Cumberland Farms, and so they had a very lengthy discussion.
I agree with Elaine. The difference would be that there's nobody there behind the counter serving you. Like a Dunkin' Donuts, they're going to get your food and they're going to serve it at the counter, but at Cumberland Farms, they're not. They're just, you bring it up, they're going to bring it up and they pay for it themselves.
I was thinking you see it at a counter. I mean,
right.
As opposed to go walk up to a counter.
Yeah, no, Zach felt it was kind of like a Panera or something where you go up and order at a counter. That would be counter service.
Okay. Does a McDonald's, do I walk up to the counter and then I order it?
Yeah.
But that doesn't count as a restaurant?
It is a restaurant. Yeah.
Okay.
Because they're serving you.
And Subway would count, right? Subway counts.
What about the deli price job?
No, they thought that did not...
That
provide
doesn't count.
Table. It doesn't provide service to you.
But you would order your sandwich.
They have a sit-down part of
it. Right, they do. I mean,
they sit-down coffee.
They have hot foods. You can order your hot foods or your coffee at the Starbucks in there and go sit down. I mean, that's...
Well, so it could be potentially considered a restaurant, or part of it anyway.
Part of it is. David, I think you had a question?
Yeah, there's only one instance I can think of that used to be in town about this, and that was Colella's, where you could walk up, order a sandwich, they would make it for you and hand it to you. That would be a takeout, but they also had a Red Barn in there as well at one point where you could sit down and eat. So would Colella's have been classified as a restaurant?
Well, probably not the whole thing, but maybe that small area of it.
Okay.
I'm sure the Board of Health thought of them as a restaurant. At least I hope they did. Okay.
So for clarification to the chair and Brian Karp's point, seating is what's the key to counter or table service. Is that the intent?
Well, if to Frank's point, if it's that and it says and that may include indoor and outdoor seating areas, maybe you have to say and not may, will include indoor and outdoor.
Well, Zach was mindful that there are some that don't have seating, such as Snappy Dogs or something like that, or some other location might not have seating, but it still should be considered a restaurant.
Subway. They don't have it.
So be with or without seating. But then they felt it was important to make the distinction on parking. So that's why there's two different requirements. One, restaurants with seating and restaurants without seating.
Through the chair.
Yep.
One thing that's popping up, and I looking at calculations on Dunkin' and Starbucks, one thing that's popping up in communities that don't have food drive-throughs, not that Hopkinton would, is something similar to what CVS is doing, which is the pull up and we bring the prescription to your car. There are some communities where restaurants, Dunkin' Donuts type restaurants, or don't have drive-throughs, but you can order ahead of time and they will bring your coffee to the car in special spots that have been reserved for that. I don't know how you take account into that, looking at the parking requirement calculations for the proposed Dunkin' and the existing Starbucks. This seems to increase both. So I'm more comfortable with it, but just keep in the back of the mind that seems to be the next big thing to bypass. Restrictions on drive-throughs is the
car service
designating a couple of spots and running coffee and donuts.
CVS out. Has a couple people on roller skates yet?
Applebee's doesn't.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Curbside service.
Well,
I would suggest that we don't allow that in our town because that's just getting around the window drive-through. Just a way around it.
Although it's convenient people with mobility issues.
Yeah. Okay.
Point of clarification.
Yep.
Would this cover? I'm gonna probably ask the same question again. So Cumberland Farms and the Dunkin' Donuts and the mobile station, those would be covered by this because they prepare food.
And they have counter service.
I guess if it's not clear, should we make it clearer?
I don't think the gas station would, according to the way we were talking. I think Cumberland Farms, yes, Subway, yes. But the gas station, they're not serving.
Yeah.
The Dunkin' Donuts.
Oh, if you're talking about Dunkin' Donuts, I'm talking about the Cumberland Farms across the street.
Yeah, but not if you're buying just a candy bar or something.
Right.
So I guess the question is, do you think it needs to be clearer? Because the building inspector is going to be interpreting.
Well, but that is counter service.
Right.
I mean, if somebody has a pot of hot coffee, does that...
No, if somebody's going to get their own coffee, that's different from when you, like at Dunkin' at Cumberland Farms, when you go over and you order a sandwich or a pretzel or whatever it is that they're preparing for you and then handing you. Something you prepare yourself, I don't consider that a restaurant, that's convenience. But something that is being prepared for you, which they do at Cumberland Farms, they do at the mobile station and the Dunkin' Donuts in the mobile station, those prepared food, someone's preparing food, handing it to you over a counter.
Okay. I might be mistaken, but I thought the Cumberland Farms in our town doesn't make sandwiches for you.
They do.
And they heat things up for you.
They have pizza and hot dogs.
They don't like you, Dave.
Hot dogs, yeah. I just saw the pre-made
stuff. Because you could buy a prepared sandwich at the supermarket. You don't need to actually have someone make it for you, which that would be considered the same.
But they also make them at Price Chopper, like they do at Subway. You can get an 8 sandwich.
Yeah, they'll make it for you, but they also have a counter where you can just buy a sandwich and leave, like Cumberland has as well. It's pre-made, which is basically not counter service.
So if a portion of these various places were considered restaurants as an accessory use, that would be fine. It would be allowed in those districts. It might just affect their parking requirement. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And we do say principal business, too, in here. So the accessory business would be separate. Mm-hmm. Any more comments, questions from the audience or townspeople? Yeah.
I have an observation.
Yeah.
The restaurants that are in the Mass Pike rest area, I thought they were all in Westboro, but I'm looking at online, and they're all actually all in Hopkinton. Just outside the question. I'm just noticing that. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I mean, and we're not going to be able to do much with that because they're on state property. Okay. I think we're ready for a vote to take the restaurant bylaw change to define a restaurant and set up parking and entertain a motion to put it on the warrant and recommend it to town meeting.
So moved.
Do I hear a second? I hear a second. Further discussion?
Just one point. I think we talked about a bunch of different things, and I think they did a good job of writing it up the best they could.
Okay, I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries unanimously. Okay, now we're talking about parking requirement for hotels. This is item number 5 on page 5. And Elaine, why don't you try this one?
So it came to Zach's attention that we allow hotels in the hotel overlay district, but it did not have a parking requirement. So they thought it would be important to have one. So we did notice that there is one in the Osmond district. And so they thought about just moving that so that it applied everywhere. But then in looking at the requirement, which is one space for every room for occupancy, they thought it should be bumped up a little bit, that in reality the parking requirement might be a little higher than that. So they bumped it up to 1.2 for each unit available for occupancy.
And that's close to some industry standard or something?
They felt that it was closer to the standard, yep.
Is there an industry standard?
There was discussion of that. I'm pretty sure that was discussed. It was 1 to 1.5, I think something like that.
Okay. John.
A question. Go back to our restaurant. If there was a restaurant in the hotel, that would be considered a second use with its own parking requirement in addition to these.
Right, and we require a restaurant and hotels. Right.
So,
go ahead, Frank.
The hotel will definitely be packed on the weekend of the marathon. So this is definitely a real concern, need. How solid is it? Like, what are the metrics to get to 1.2 as opposed to like 1.5?
I think Zach felt that this was a minimum, and that if a hotel felt that their need was greater, they could build more than that. But they thought that the occupancy generally for hotels is much lower than that. It's like, you know, do you plan for the parking during the Christmas retail season, or do you plan it for the rest of the year? So they, in kind of looking at it that way, they thought that 1.2 was reasonable for a vast majority of the period of time. And if the hotel felt that they needed more spaces, then they should plan for that.
All right, I'm just concerned about, it's definitely going to be, if there is a hotel, it would definitely be sold out during the marathon weekend. And I'm just concerned if we don't set the bar a little bit higher, kind of get that out of the way now, the developers will come in and say, okay, we need at least 1.5 spaces, if that's the industry standard, and for safety, and you know, we don't want to be at risk during, you know, especially that weekend is very high security. So I think if we set the bar a little bit higher, the developers will be more prepared to deal with that reality.
I think they felt it was more common for there to be one car per room rather than more than that.
Yeah. I mean, when I used to travel with a bunch of four or five guys, you know, they all had their own room, but we shared one car going to whatever business they were at, so I don't know, right? The real question is, what really is the standard per se? And I think that's the question.
I think Zach was looking at the 0.2 as, you know, this maybe some meeting room space and, you know, restaurant space and for the additional just employees and so forth.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
Through the chair here, I'd actually feel more comfortable looking at 1.5, looking at the industry standard. Not just that weekend that Frank mentioned here, but doing a lot of traveling myself, depending on the size of the facility, oftentimes it is packed on a business night, or if there's a number of different activities going on, or if there's a restaurant attached to it, or if there's, I'll say, convention, or if there's a meeting space available connected to it as well, you'll get more cars there at the facility than just the hotel itself. So I would kind of err on the side of having more than enough parking spaces, and then have the developer figure out what's appropriate given the size of the lot that they've acquired.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
I'd take the opposite of that, because with a 1.5 minimum, we're forcing them to build a bigger parking lot that may not be used, and I'd be more for green spaces than parking lots.
And they can make an exception. They could kind of try to appeal that then.
And to Fran's point, they have functions at these hotels. They don't just count on their drive-through driving traffic. You're going to have conventions. You're going to have meeting place. You're going to have weddings, and the employees and the staff. If that's not part of this, then you're asking for trouble. You're going to start having people parking all over the place.
When we amended the hotel, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
When we amended the hotel bylaws, didn't we downsize the function room, the ballroom, whatever you want to call it, because hotels aren't building that anymore?
A lot of them aren't, yeah. I mean, there's not a requirement by square foot of, you know, nowhere near like the hotel over there in Westboro on Route 9.
It went way down.
It went significantly
down. I thought I remembered it being downsized. Mm-hmm. And by downsizing it, then, you know, I agree there needs to be more than one space per room. You know, where that one's, how much more? I guess that is up for debate, and I guess that's what Zach did, is debate it.
Okay. John?
I think I kind of agree with most of the comments, but if we're not going to have additional requirements for function rooms, etc., we're saying they're not required to build doesn't mean they aren't going to build them. So if they build them and we have no mechanism to account for those function rooms, then I'm more comfortable with the higher requirement.
But if you know you're going to build it and you're a business, you're going to want to make money and you're going to want to make sure that you have the parking there. Just because there's a minimum of 1.2, you may decide you want 1.4 or 1.5 or 1.7.
But not all folks seem to do that.
Yes, you start by what you're saying. Yeah. You look at, you know, it doesn't necessarily, yeah. History doesn't hold
that. On the other hand, I am sure because the parking lot is full that Starbucks is not selling as much as they might have if somebody saw a bunch of empty spots in that location. So maybe self-limiting somewhat. But
we're saying a 100-room hotel will have 120 parking spaces. That for employees, that's for anyone visiting the hotel. We'll have 20 spaces basically if it's full. I don't think that's a lot of parking when you add up the amount of people you'll need to even run the hotel. I understand it's a minimum requirement. Just wondering if 1.5 wouldn't be a better choice. Kind of try to save the developer from themselves.
Why don't we get some more information on the standards? And I'd entertain a motion to put this onto the warrant. So we have a placeholder. We still have a month to play with wording, but we're looking at playing with some numbers here potentially.
I would agree. I think we just need to agree on a number, right? And I think we can do that as a board.
Or, you know, we could also agree on a number with a waiver allowance, you know, by the board too.
Actually, you already have that in the in the off-street parking section. You can grant a reduction special permit.
Okay, so that part. Okay, so entertain a motion to put parking requirements for hotels on the warrant, with an understanding that we will do more research on number of spaces per unit.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Oh, first of all, is there any public comment more on hotels? Okay. Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
I just wanted to stick one more comment in.
Yep.
I seem like I'm the only really true, not true, but encouragement of the green factor here. I would just ask people the next time they're at Target in Westboro to look at that parking lot and tell me how many cars park in the three quarters facing Route 9, and it just seems like a waste of asphalt, but...
If I may, through the chair, to your earlier comment about trees, they can have parking garages, so it's more parking and less space.
Okay. I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries unanimously. Signed bylaw changes. Lane, do you want to start off with this one?
Yeah, Design Review Board recommended a couple of changes to the sign bylaw. One is that prohibit wall and projecting signs above the first floor of a building, and to prohibit signs on parapet walls, and also to reduce the maximum height of standing signs from 10 feet to 8 feet. Also, in looking at it, the ZAC actually came up with the idea of changing the special permit granting authority from the Board of Appeals to the Planning Board, since the Planning Board typically reviews building designs. So that part came from ZAC, but the rest of it came from Design Review Board. So that's what they've proposed here for your consideration.
Okay, let's take the last one first. Did they get the Board of Appeals to sign off on this?
Well, the representative of the Board of Appeals on ZAC said he fully in favor.
Yeah, of course, he didn't want to deal with signs like nobody wants to deal with signs. I'm not sure that the logic that they had on that one makes any sense at all. I mean, the Board of Appeals does do building designs and looks at building requirements more so than us, and they do more exceptions than stuff like that. So, I don't know. And they have the other part of the sign stuff other than the placing. So I will admit I'm not in favor of that particular paragraph of it. But that's just me on that one. Let's talk about the change from... Let's break this question into three parts, because there really are three different parts to it. Let's start off with the last one, which is converting it to, from the responsibility from the Board of Appeals to the Planning Board. Does anyone on the Planning Board think that's a good idea?
No. Design review.
Well, if I may, to the chair?
Yeah.
I agree it's kind of a weird split. But my thinking is the Board of Appeals are appointed. They have professional expertise on the board that's geared more towards construction or signs are more maybe design review, but we're an elected board, and we I guess we have more of a town-wide responsibility. Board of Appeals has for people that come to them with their concerns. So we're maybe we're more better positioned to make decisions on signs. But I agree with Vinny. Maybe design review could be like the initial committee that looks at things.
Well, by statute, there's only three entities that can grant special permits, and that's the Planning Board, the Board of Appeals, and the Board of Selectmen. So those are the options.
And Design Review Board does look at all signs prior to the issuance of building permits, so they do look at them, but they can't grant the special permit.
The special permit for sign granting is, if you wanted another off-locate premises sign, I believe that's one of the things they can permit. Is there other, what
it's,
other?
It's anything that doesn't comply with the sign bylaw. So the special permit provision is there to avoid variance applications because the variance standard is so high that you can never meet it with a sign.
Right.
So to be flexible, there's a special permit provision.
Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
Don't we, as a board, create the verbiage and enforce it? And isn't there a benefit, I think is what you guys are saying as well, to having a separate entity doing the appeal, so you would be appealing to the same group that, I mean, isn't that how it works with most of the other appeals? They're actually appealing to a separate group.
How many of these are they hearing lately?
Maybe one a year. Not too many.
So far it's not been a terrible time consuming.
Why do they want to change it?
I just thought it made sense because it seemed to be the placement of signs on buildings, at least in Design Review Board's mind, is linked to the design of the building, a lot of which comes out of site plan review. So it's originating, the design of the site is originating here, and that's where they thought that more thought could be put into the overall sign package as it relates to the building.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but when you're ready, I do have photographic examples.
Go ahead.
Of the signs.
These are the sorts of issues we're seeing. So like on some buildings, when it's a single tenant, like having a big sign above the second floor makes sense. Like these are some examples where, you know, it looks totally appropriate. But when you get like a big building with 10 tenants or more, the idea that they're going to be putting, you know, 10 signs on second and third floor, that's where we felt like a special permit would be more appropriate. And these are some buildings in town that we have that have multiple tenants and multiple stories. So they could potentially be asking, you know, for 10 to 12 signs.
For our viewers at home, this is Amy Ritterbush.
From the Design Review Board.
And this one does have signs on the outside.
It does have, I gotta, there it is. That's the one they have so far. These are just some other buildings where it would be, you know, where it could come up.
Do you have the ones that we saw?
This is the one we were particularly concerned about because it was really squeezed in. There was no designated place really for a sign, but they really wanted to have a sign, and they were within their square footage requirement. So this is the one that came up this year.
That's the new one on Lumber Street, right? One Lumber Street, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Right.
Is it?
Yep.
Yeah, and then there's also the issues with 77 West Main, the Dynasty one.
That's this one, yeah. But they have kind of, we didn't look at these this year, but they have a whole bunch here and there of all different shapes and sizes.
Yeah. If you look at it, it doesn't look.
And there's a realtor sign over in the Hopkinton Square, I believe, that's up on the second floor.
Yeah. So anyway, that was our thought process.
Yeah, so I think when we get to the point of, you know, second floor signs, definitely we'll...
Yeah, and I don't think Design Review, or David might remember too, had a preference whether it was Board of Appeals or Planning Board that
reviewed. Yeah, no, I don't think we have
to. It's just that we can't.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly, came up with that.
But I'll leave these with you guys in case you want.
Well, let's talk about that once more.
Yeah, talk about it.
The concern that I had when I was reading through this one, if we were going to get the hotel, they're going to want to put the sign up in the top corner of the building somewhere. Mm-hmm. And every hotel that you see, I mean, they're going to have to do, you know, if we're going to try to get the hotel in town, we've got to be a little bit more flexible, I think.
Yeah, so if we read, if I may, the what we're talking about now, if we're just talking about second floor signage, it says no portion of any wall sign or projecting sign shall be above the first story of a building. So I think we do need to elaborate on that.
I mean,
but did you want to stick to the last one first?
Well, let's open it up to that one next, because that's the harder.
Let me make one more comment. I'm comfortable with advice and decisions from Design Review about signs if the Planning Board is going to take over from the Board of Appeals on signs. So my question earlier was kind of, I feel better now with more information, so thank you.
Okay.
So I don't know if there's a way you can write it so that something like this, it's a single tenant building or the hotel, obviously it would make sense that their sign would be above the first.
Could be the exception to the rule.
I wonder maybe if you could write it so that if it's the if there's no signs at the first level or something like that.
Right.
If the only sign is it.
Well, they will have a sign at the first level.
Yeah, they would have like an entrance sign.
No, not on the building, though.
On the hotels? They do in Boston. They have right over the marquee in the front, and then they have one up top. Especially if you're aiming towards 495, why wouldn't you put your sign up? Mm-hmm. Right. You want people to see that.
Sure. Right, I made a shot, Vincent. You're up now. Come on, what do you got better than that?
Better than that?
Tree top design.
I think it needs to be a case-to-case unless we're going to use the hotel district as its own separate sign entity. And say in that area you can put a sign up. Or if you're the only tenant of the building, you can put it up.
How about this?
Industrial district? Maybe?
Why can't we say that the sign at the top has to be for the same company as the bottom? I mean, we're just trying to avoid different companies from having different signs all over the place. I think we'd be okay with multiple signs if it was the same company.
But now we run the risk of the first floor tenant saying, okay, my business has a sign. I'm sorry, you don't have one on the second floor. So now you have to come up with some way to make it fair.
Well, that's why you have a single tenant building has the exception.
Right, and then correct for multiple.
But what if you're not in a single tenant building? If you're in a development that
has a tombstone one like that.
Right.
Well, then we have to put that in.
Well, the tombstone is there, but the real question is, do we really need to regulate second floor store? You know, signs is that.
Unless you want to keep seeing things like 77 West Main Street.
I think you do, because otherwise they're going to take advantage of...
You're going to put something in your window.
Right. Because
you want people to know where you are. That's right.
And I would say, actually, that these pictures don't really do it justice. If you go down and actually look at the buildings, you'll see that it's pretty much an eyesore. Signs all over the place, which we're trying to avoid, you know?
I'm just going to caution us. Well, let's talk the 12 foot versus or 10 feet versus 8 feet. When I tried to do what Zach did a few years ago and rewrote the sign bylaw, my feeling on that was, if the signs that are the pedestal type, two posts in the ground with a sign in it, if they're up a little bit higher, you can actually see through and under them, and you know it's easier to get the traffic going along. So I don't like, I'll say, like the gas station pedestal tombstone type signs as much, because quite frankly, I find them blocking more so than if the sign had been up and I could see air through it. So I worry that any time we lower it, we're making a fence as opposed to a window. And that would be my analogy. But so I'm not crazy about that one. I will also caution you, having spent many years trying to get a sign bylaw change to town meeting, this is the one that everyone is an expert on, and it's incredibly difficult to get two-thirds. And if we were to do it, and you felt strongly about one of these items, you might want to limit this year's article to one of those three items that we're trying to include in here, because you might overload it with two more and you will lose it all. And so, but those, that's just town meeting advice.
I think the recommendation, the only recommendation from the design review board was the second floor signs, right? Everything
else. We did both, but I think we felt more strongly about the second floor.
What was the other one?
About reducing it, the maximum height.
The height, okay.
Was it 10 to 8, I think. And, like, it really doesn't look bad on these buildings with all these tenants, but, like, there's a couple small historic buildings, I want to say 25 Main Street or so, that have, they can still have a 10-foot sign, even though they only have a couple of tenants, and the sign really dwarfs the building. But
the problem we found in signs is proportionality. I mean, to me, the one of the worst signs is if I go up to Acton and they have this old Kmart that this is huge building, and I think the Acton sign bylaw requires a 4x4 foot square, and I mean, you're looking across the huge Kmart parking lot, and oh, geez, is that a Kmart or not? Because there's this sign that's this big. It looks like to me like a for sale sign on it on the building, but it's maybe it is not. Yes. Well, I'm talking many years back.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
To your point of only suggesting one as opposed to four, which I think is a good idea, I'd like to make a motion that we just address the second story signs. I don't know if there would be a second for that or not.
Well, we have a motion. Is there a second?
Can you clarify? I'm sorry.
Instead of attacking all four of these, let's just attack the one with the second floor.
But there's six.
There's four so base, items.
I think the parapet walls kind of goes along with that. It's up, it's at the top of the building.
So it'd be...
Okay. That's one of the Zach.
It'd be one and two?
Mm-hmm.
So your motion is to only look at one and two.
Which are together in the wording that's proposed.
Just keying off the chairman's advice in many years of his experience. How's that for sacking up?
Through the chair. I see one as a kind of prohibition. There's no reason why that should be allowed. And on number two is where we're looking at potential exceptions for either single occupancy or a hotel or something like that. So I don't necessarily want to lump them together because I think the parapet ones, I don't see any reason to allow those under any circumstances.
Why not?
And they are above the first story.
Yeah, right.
Look over your shoulder. I don't know what these other ones are, but someone else has to listen. Keep the list of the changes. Okay. Oh,
right. So, can I ask a question through the chair for some clarification?
Mm-hmm. So,
Amy, on this picture from West Main Street, mm-hmm. or Lumber Street,
this one?
Would this bylaw change mean...
That this wouldn't be allowed without a special permit. This would still be first story signage, and this would need the special permit.
And currently, that was okay because we didn't really cover it. We didn't cover it in our bylaws.
They just are limited to a certain number of square footage of signage.
Just, yeah, we just require a certain square footage, and as long as they're within that, they qualify.
But of all these examples, that's. I think most of them, they're like, all pretty much fine. I mean...
Yeah, so these two would be... These are for second floor tenants, so these would be the ones that would not be.
I think like the Price Chopper stores, across from Price Chopper, might kind of fall into the same issue.
Mm-hmm. The problem, I guess the problem is, where do you sign the second floor tenants? That kind of is what you're really asking. I mean,
well, if you prohibit it, then they're almost restricted then to...
These signs. Yeah.
Yeah.
Show me a gas station that doesn't have a sign 10, 15 feet in the air. Don't they all?
Not any. Well, there haven't been any new ones in Hopkinton.
Well, but all the old ones.
Sure. A lot of them grandfathered through. But when Cumberland Farms, you know, they now have a tombstone sign. So.
And let's just not think of this as a two-story issue, because it could be a three- or four-story building as well. Mm-hmm. Right? You mm-hmm. could have signs on all four stories.
No question. Three. Does that hurt from if you're either a developer or you own a facility and you're trying to bring in tenants, and then they then want to be able to leverage the fact that I'm on the second or third floor to put something in the window or some type of advertisement, and now we're saying no, you have to abide by the tombstone, that's the only external advertising that we're allowing.
I think we're going to get pushback from Chamber of Commerce folks on this change.
Well, we're not saying we're not going to allow it, because it can be through the appeal, right?
That's why special we had permit. To allow special permit. Had to, but that's why 85 Main Street, I think you can picture that one. The brick building, the old high school, he came in and requested signage under every single window, because his argument was, I can't rent these spaces because there's no signage, there's no visible signage, and that's a detriment to my business. So the design review board, I actually don't think either one of these two are on the design review board, the one that he came in, and they approved, you know, 18 square foot signs under each one of those windows. So now you're going to have 9 signs across that whole building. You know,
and they're really hidden by trees anyway. So, like, I think this is more visible from the street, the monument that they have. But.
Through the chair.
Yep.
Having been involved in probably between 3,000 and 5,000 offices of various sizes over my too long career, most communities wouldn't permit the amount of signs that we have flying around for a small tenant. And I also argue at the point that if you look at a building in Westboro or Southboro, the large buildings with multiple tenants, you don't see every tenant having a sign. It's a street sign and the major tenant has a sign. I also and part of it is it's common in the area and it's common in Hopkinton. But I also question on a lot of these, can you actually read it? If you're traveling on Main Street and you're looking for somebody and you don't have the address, you can't read half these signs if you're going at speed limit, because they're so tiny and they're so illegible, especially at night, if they're not lit properly. So I think the argument that you can't rent a second floor, look at the surrounding communities, they're all larger office buildings and renting lots of second floors without having the signs.
And just to add on to that, Mr. Chair,
mm-hmm.
I think we're for business in this town, everybody's for business in this town, but I don't think we should sacrifice our integrity as a town.
Okay. So, I believe you have a motion, but I didn't hear a second.
Correct.
Is there a second to...
Can we repeat the motion?
The motion was to just, and I'll go with just number two.
Was it two or three?
There were some questions about including two and one, so I'd like to make the motion just to focus on number two for the second floor signs.
Just number two now?
Yeah, because John had a point of wanting to separate those.
Well, but John, I think John's point was he was okay with number one prohibiting.
Yeah, I think number one is a straight prohibition. Okay. Number two is the one we're having the discussion on, if it's a hotel or a single occupant.
Okay. All right, I'll include both, because my big point is number two.
The parapet, the one?
No, that's the second floor signs.
Maybe sure, we're looking at this wrong. We're looking at it from the tenant perspective. Maybe we should be looking at it. This should be geared towards the landlord. Perhaps we need to have a bylaw that the landlord has to supply a tombstone sign, instead of the tenants coming to us and saying, I need a sign in my window. Well, they should be going to the landlord, and the landlord should be coming to us.
Well, I think it's the landlord is making the application to the
tenant.
Well,
if there's a requirement that he has a second-story tenant, then he needs to have some type of signage in the front that designates that tenant. Is that better served than trying to tell him he needs to get a special permit from us every time for a second-story window?
I think in the situations we're talking about, correct me if I'm wrong, Henry, but they do have the tombstone that they sign up front, and they're just looking for a second sign.
I don't know that you just want to require a monument sign, not a tombstone sign. either, though, on every single building, because that's a lot of monument signs in this town that I don't necessarily think are necessary.
Well, all right, so a designated area in the front of the building that will tell you
right, but
tenants.
I don't think you want to necessarily require it, though, is what I'm saying.
Well, it would eliminate the need for a second story sign.
But these businesses are asking for both. Like this Femme aux Femmes Homes also has a, she's also on the monument sign.
I don't think you can make a motion on top of my motion. Annie, I don't know.
So.
So the motion on the floor is to just discuss number two.
One,
right?
And two.
One and two. I'm fine with one and two.
Just
to the, like I said, the chairman's point of not trying to overwhelm town meeting. The signage changes are hard to get approved.
But number two is just, that's for everyone, right? There's no,
I'm not saying as written. I think we can work on the wording. I'm just saying that we stop discussing the other two.
So no reduction in height and no change in the special permit granting.
Correct. Yep. Because that's what I'm hearing from the board as well, that those are not really hot items. Just trying to narrow our focus a little bit more.
Okay. So do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, we have a second. So basically, is it just to discuss it at this point? Make sure I'm clear, make sure that Kobe's clear. What do we got on the motion here? Is this to recommend?
So far, just to talk about it.
Just to talk about it. Well, maybe we ought to change the motion to recommend a town meeting sign modification contained in paragraphs 1 and 2 only.
And can I put something in there about rewording number two? So that it won't be as restrictive as we want it to, if possible.
You're saying basically for exception for a hotel. Well, we can't talk about what the usage is on a sign.
Right.
If you said it was for a hotel, then you're
that's right. No first content.
No content.
Or can we put something in there? Probably not the right thing to do, but saying that it can be done with a special permit is probably not something we want to call out, right?
Why wouldn't you want to call it out?
Because you could say that with anything you write in this document. But I mean, yeah, maybe if you guys, I mean, I'd be okay with that.
You might be calling out it and kind of implying a lesser standard to be met, maybe.
Is it like on South Street that this would be occurring for the most part in the industrial A district?
Could you just say in the hotel overlay district?
You could do that. You could allow.
Does that include industrial? Or?
Well, it includes some industrial A and some industrial B.
You want to include the Osmond too, right?
And it would eliminate the downtown.
I don't think we want to sign at the top of a building on the Osmond.
Hotel,
it's allowed, but I don't know if that's the correct place for.
Okay.
And would this be for the primary tenant only, or who would this potentially apply
for? The building, right?
You could allow one sign on the top of a building, and then basically they decide, you know, which company is on, the major tenant or.
Mr. Chair, why can't we just limit that to single-tenant buildings?
Because it wouldn't solve our problem with multi-tenants and
They don't get assigned.
Above the second floor.
Yeah.
There are some buildings that would have just two major
tenants
mm-hmm. or three major tenants, and I'd be okay with them each having a sign up top, but not 6, 7, 8.
I like just a single sign. Yeah. And then let the landlord and the tenants figure out which one it is.
This is a team motion, so.
Oh, sure.
I'm receptive.
Because a single sign can mention two businesses, right? It could be a hotel and a restaurant. all on one sign, right?
I'm thinking about like two different companies. You got Dell EMC and HP or something right next to each other. And so you see that on Route 9 in Southborough. You see a couple signs up there, and it looks fine.
But majority ones, if you drive up 128,
yep,
right north of Waltham, up by Burlington, yep, you'll have one that'll say a big software company, right? Okay. There might be multiple tenants in there,
yep,
but you've got one that drives that. And that's probably Cisco, you name it, to have a single one.
If everybody else is okay with one sign, I am okay with one sign. In combination with the zoning, or we don't even need to do that?
Well, you could do...
I like the industrial hotel.
Okay. Both the industrial and the hotel, because that kind of takes it out of the residential.
So that's industrial A and B, or just A? Industrial B is Lumber Street as well.
Yeah, but
Yale Harvey. A few other places.
Would those buildings, would one Lumber Street fall into that?
Or it's its own district, right? No, it's a separate district. But the other side of Lumber Street, the opposite side. A portion of which is in the hotel overlay, I think.
Well, all the smaller buildings, I don't care, quite frankly. It's the hotel. So I would say industrial A and the hotel overlay.
Yeah.
And that's one sign at the top?
Yeah.
Well, town council can wordsmith that.
Yeah.
Lane, you can work on it tomorrow, too. Please.
Elaine, can you just take my motion and run with it, please?
Okay.
What is it across the street?
Did you want to ask for a public
number?
It's industrial B.
Any questions, comments from members of the public? Okay, I think we're ready for a vote to recommend 1 and 2 of the signed bylaw to town meeting. Or not to recommend it, to place it on the warrant today. And let's come back to our recommendation.
Do we need to vote on the motion?
We will.
Or is that not what we're doing now?
That's what we're going to do right now.
Okay.
Everyone clear? We're voting to recommend basically paragraph 1 and paragraph 2 with that modification.
To number 2, correct.
To 2.
Modification being hotel overlay district, industrial A.
One sign.
Why are you expecting
one sign per building?
It's much smaller, and the buildings are all smaller.
What's the building there? Happening in Stone Garden or the Lumber Street Auto?
There's also the rest of Elmwood Park. Now, but who knows what's going to be there in the future?
It could be taller.
It's right on the highway.
Yep.
I kind of agree with Brian. Well, let's just include it. Because if you're going to Elmwood Park, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay, let's try and add B. So anyway, the motion now would be to modify 2 to include industrial A and B and the hotel.
I can vote for that.
Single sign. And the one in single sign for?
Single sign. You want to be able to show on the highway.
Point of clarification?
Yep.
And this is at the, and we'd be, by voting this, we'd be ignoring 3, 4, 5, and 6?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Come back maybe next year if we still feel strong with it.
If we have success with this one.
See where we get in town meeting on what, too. I mean, in Elaine, when we put the order on the town meeting, mm-hmm, this one's going to be about dead last.
Do you want the photographs, or
are
you good?
Maybe.
So this is the one more question. Okay. Okay. One.
Go ahead, Frank.
The question is, guys, I guess through
records.
Go ahead, Frank.
To Elaine. Just for clarification, the Board of Appeals has or has not said what they thought of this item 6?
They have not.
But the one member on the board of Zach, that's from Board of Appeals, is for it.
That was a great idea.
Less responsibility on his plate.
Okay.
I might go to a special town meeting for my amendment.
You should go. I think you should support it.
Do a special meeting. We're going to have one.
Okay.
I don't want a sandwich
board. Okay.
The vote.
Yes.
Let's see. So anyway, we do need to vote on the on putting a sign, a limited sign bylaw change. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain?
I'm abstaining.
Okay. Okay, we're now next on...
quick question, so does this put it on the warrant and recommend?
No, just putting it on the warrant. We'll recommend it once we see the final language on that one. Okay. The... and now this
driveways,
is,
yeah.
This, and we'll get to driveways in a second here. I'd like to remind people that we've already voted on the marijuana moratorium bylaw at an earlier meeting, so that will be another one on that. And then there are two proposed amendments that we're going to have to vote on. And I'd like to vote on those at this time. The additional proposed amendments are twofold here. One was the utility structures. Now, we voted already to put that on the town meeting in our last meeting. This is when we had the discussion about the gas building. I think everyone remembers that. I think Zach drafted it a little bit better and caught the fact that we, at one point we already allowed telephone exchanges in the residential areas. So I would recommend a vote to revise our utility.
This is not a public hearing, you know that, right?
This is not necessarily a public hearing item. But
we still have to hold a public hearing on.
We will have to hold a public hearing on, yes. And we will recommend it at that point. But basically, I'm going to entertain a motion because I want to get all the zoning stuff done first before I go on to driveway standards.
I see. Okay.
So the utility structures, basically, in Elaine's handout, I think it's Elaine's, that was on the table tonight, she had a utility structure item, and basically what I want to do is to remove what we had drafted the last time and include this. So I entertain a motion to do that.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Okay. So do we need further discussion on that?
What was the exact motion?
It was to take the current wording and replace what we talked about, I think. Was it last meeting?
Yeah.
Yep.
It's replaced with this language, correct?
Correct.
And the biggest difference with this language is?
There's some conflicting language in one of the districts that would come out.
And what language specifically is conflicting?
The telephone exchange buildings are allowed by right, and you wanted to make everything by special permit. So.
Okay.
Okay, so I think I have a motion, correct. Kobe?
Yes.
Yep.
Second.
Do we have any further discussion needed on that? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. By the way, I think it is tomorrow night at Elmwood School, Jim, at 6:30.
8:30, yeah.
They are talking about that gas takeoff metering building that'll go on Elm Street. So, Elmwood School, 6:30. So, okay, then Zach came up with another last one. It's on the back page here regarding nuisances, which basically says that I got to clean up my backyard.
Or fence it.
This isn't the rooster one, is it?
No. This is not the rooster, no. And basically, you just can't allow crap to be flying around, I guess.
And how is this?
Crap is very subjective, isn't it?
How is this enforcement, Mr. Chairman, if I'm not sure if that's
the point?
Elaine? The zoning bylaw, so it's enforced by the zoning enforcement officer, building inspector, like any other zoning bylaw.
So So basically, if you think that your neighbor is has too many second-hand items, and any items such as junk, scrap, rubble, debris, building salvage, abandoned buildings, machinery, wreckage of damaged or demolished buildings, or other discarded second-hand items.
Coleman.
Is there a law 30 now?
30 days in jail and $15,000 fine.
Yeah. So if someone's barn collapses, that's considered demolished building?
Remnants of, I suppose, yeah.
Through the chair, and to answer Vince's question, there was a bylaw we, maybe 10 years ago, designed to have only so many used cars on a property or so many items on any property, if there's because there was one house that had trucks and cars, and I thought there could have been a better way to handle it, but it passed, I believe.
We do
it?
Have a so you can only have one unregistered vehicle.
Unregistered.
So this doesn't address vehicles per se.
Well, abandoned vehicles.
Right. Yeah, abandoned. So yeah, unregistered.
I mean, this could have been taking place over there on Elm Street in basically lumber when we had that abandoned trailer and debris field that's all cleaned up now.
So, but, Mr. Chair, I'm for this kind of stuff, but I'm just wondering if it's going to create a lot of feedback at the town meeting. A lot of pushback.
You'll have a public hearing in end of March or beginning of April on this.
Yeah, because there's no time limit on this. What if you're doing construction and you've got debris and for a month while you're waiting to finish?
Well, if not directly utilized by illegally operating use, you know.
My wife's had this bylaw for decades. I can't use anything in my yard. That bylaw already exists in my house. I can't fit in the garage. I can't have it.
So, like, does a flamingo fall into this category? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of great areas.
Flamingos, yeah. I got nothing. It's not allowed.
Well, like I said, we can discuss this at a further point.
This is probably like pornography. You know it when you see it.
Or your neighbor knows it when they call it in.
Yeah.
And who enforces this? The building inspector?
Yeah.
Okay. And I'd entertain a motion to put nuisances by law or removal of nuisances by law onto the town meeting warrant. I'm not hearing anyone stepping up to this one.
That's too subjective.
I agree.
I tend to agree.
I can be considered a nuisance in some circles. So no.
I sense that it's not going very far tonight.
Okay. So would somebody want to make a motion to not recommend it?
We don't have to do that.
Right, so now you don't have to have a public hearing unless someone submits it as a citizen's petition.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Who was pushing for that, by the way?
It was
in the committee.
No one in particular. We're just
accumulating
comments over the years, and it was on the list.
Okay. Okay. I think I've got everything that we, from a zoning bylaw. We're going to driveways or is a general bylaw?
Okay.
So at this time, I'd entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
With the provision that you can still amend the wording and so forth at future meetings.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I'll make that motion.
I think we got a motion and a second out of that. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Now let's talk about driveway standards. There's a general bylaw, and this board has done sponsored general bylaws in the past, but this sounds to me like this ought to be co-sponsored by our chief, and we'd be happy to go with him, I think. Well, we'll find that out in a second. But basically, this is part of the discussion on what a bylaw looks like. Come on.
Would you like me to come up?
Yeah.
In the front row.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for having me.
So, basically, for everyone out in TV land, there is a requirement through the building code, I believe, that if you have a long driveway, a new long driveway, not an existing one, a new long driveway, you either have to make it 20 foot wide or sprinkle your house with a sprinkling system that isn't like put the fire all the way out, but one that'll help you get out of the house right. safely.
Yep.
So it's more like what can you do with a garden hose type sprinkler system as opposed to the industrial one that puts a fire hose into your place.
Yep, they call it a life safety sprinkler.
Yeah, which we required on all the legacy condos as a requirement. So, I mean, it's not atypical to see it being done in Hawkington. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, so the state code says make it wide enough that he can get his biggest truck right next to your house, almost, or sprinkle it. And I think that was pushed by conservative fire chiefs around that would like to make sure you get out of your house.
Yes.
And conservation conservative type folks would like to see the driveway down to 8 feet because we don't like the impervious soil or stuff. But anyway, that brought up the whole subject, and why don't we take it from you guys take it from there?
Sure. So that kind of came into my lap as I started in January. And then, as Ken mentioned, the controversy to that was the width of 20 feet, and that was like shocking to quite a few people, including the building community. So as it swung around to about October, November, I knew going into July it was struggling, and it got repealed for 1 and 2 family houses.
It did
in like November. I think it ended November 1st.
Oh.
So the coverage of it. So where does that leave us? Even as I learned about that, even in the beginning in January when I started, I realized that the town has some bylaw language, and I was trying to understand some of the exceptions you could make here. And when we talk about a driveway and construction, that's a good standards for it. Right now, the town just currently deals with the town's portion of the property at the entrance. It doesn't flow all the way through the driveway. So we don't have, in the absence of that, we don't have anything for the whole flow of the driveway that sets a standard for its construction. So the dilemma with that is, what do we do? What I proposed is I brought some of the pieces that I felt were integral of public safety access to houses. That was the problem we ran into. I had a couple of fires that I ran into that were on narrow driveways that we had trouble accessing, and I would hear about it. People were disappointed that we had trouble accessing them. So I said, okay, what can we do with this? So just I did a little work with Elaine. I tried to take forward some of what I thought was the meat of the bylaw that got us the access without it, and we tried to pare down the areas where we felt like it was having too big of an impact. So I'm going to kind of forward those ideas to you, and I've been trying to be open for feedback so that I would like this to pass town meeting. So what we came up with, again, the premise is to come up with a driveway construction standard for Hawkington. The entrance is the biggest part, and it's for public safety access. Obviously, my fire trucks tend to be the ones that are challenged the most. Cruisers and ambulances do pretty well with most of the driveways we have when we get into a fire truck, especially on a scenic road where the swing is more of a challenge. That's where the issue gets and what we're trying to deal with here. Do they all have a copy of the bylaw changes that are being recommended? Great. So I think if we just kind of get down to on number 2, and it goes just past D, explains what we're doing, and it says number 1, driveways on a lot where the front door of the principal building is less than 100 feet from the edge of the driveway travel is kind of the first example that we run into. There's two pieces of the language we're trying to do. The first thing is I'm trying to make the entrance wide enough so a fire truck can swing in. There's two ways we can do that. I talked with Beta a little bit. The easiest way is we created a couple of templates, and an example would be something like that. We created a template. And the person that wants the driveway just takes a template at the entrance and sees whether the fire truck can make the swing or not between the road to the entrance, and obviously the cost would be minimal. The second piece is you can ask for a swept path analysis, which demonstrates through some software. I gave beta, and I can give anybody, I can provide all the detail for our vehicles, and they can see whether it would go in. There's some more cost to that. You would normally use that for driveways that become more complicated, a lot of curves, and to demonstrate on the curves that the apparatus could clear it, you would use a swept path analysis. Am I doing okay so far? Okay. And then on the end of, on A, you would see if there's some examples when we get into things like there's an exception that may need to be made, you would add in this 13D, which is a life safety sprinkler system that Ken was referring to. And again, that's so you can, the idea is I'm not trying to restrict lot buildings necessarily, and I want to have an option where I could say as long as life safety is okay, you can get your house in there. Minimum widths of the driveways, 12 feet. We talked about, again, the code that we came from was 20 feet. 18 feet tended to be some national standard for language that was getting accepted, but it's still a big width in the driveway, and I heard that from a lot of people. In the 100 foot, less than 100 foot from the front door example, as long as I can get one vehicle into the driveway, and that would be, say, for a fire, my ladder truck could get there and get access to ventilate the house or make a rescue. My fire truck, on most of these examples, it would just pull to the front on the roadway, and I can stretch hose lines in, make a fire attack. It's pretty easy. Once you get past that, I need some room to be able to get in, get vehicles off, and that's why you'll start to see some examples where we widen it a little bit. So is that pretty good with number two? Everybody see there anything less than 100 feet that's just making the entrance big enough? And 12 feet is okay for me.
Number one, right?
I guess it is, yes.
2.1.
2.1, thank you. That's the way to say it, right. So as we get to number two, we're starting to get greater than 100 feet. In A, we talk about the language where, again, from the entrance of the street, we demonstrate that the vehicle can swing into the driveway. For the first... I'm going to try to see the language here, make sure I'm saying it right.
I think it's almost identical, except the addition.
Yep.
Negotiating
right.
The curves on the driveway without leaving.
So that's where the swept path analysis in a longer driveway gets kicked in. No portion of the driveway will exceed a 10% grade. That's national standard. That did come from the other code. You ask why a 10% grade, maybe. The weather is a factor in getting up the roadway, and then as you have... transitions, vehicles, especially my ladder trucks, because they have longer overhanging backs, they bottom out. So the one weakness of this beautiful ladder truck that I got is the back has that problem. Newer vehicles, they're the standards, they're jockeying the backs up higher, so there's more clearance, but they design them to this 10% grade standard and national standards for ladder trucks and things like that. That makes sense, everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. C, the minimum width of the driveway travel way shall be 18 feet for the first 50 feet and then 12 feet thereafter. What that's allowing me to do is to get a second vehicle into the driveway somehow. And then it also, with another section, kind of is part of the swing path analysis. You almost need that width anyways to make the swing for the first 50 feet. You'll see 20 feet built in a little later. But for that 50 feet, it gives them a chance to make the swing and get a little bit of room in off of the road.
And for that one, Chief, is that kind of industry standard, the 18 for the first 50 and then 12 foot beyond? Or
it's kind of a compromise of the 20 feet would normally be there. Where I need the initial width is the swing. So the ladder truck is 40 feet long. So for it to just kind of make the swing off of the roadway and now be clear and be able to get into the narrow part of the driveway, I kind of need that transition piece of it. So it's just kind of doing a little bit of math there, and it just allows us to get potentially another vehicle going in to the driveway at that point on these longer driveways. we worked a lot of compromise in here, so it's not perfect science. The intrusive language was easier because it was just 20 feet wide, and I didn't have to worry about a lot of things. We're trying to bring this back some so that the driveway meets some of the worries of, say, conservation or the widths or area that you have, but it can still do the function. So it's kind of the design of it. And again, in that first part of the driveway is where the swing is the hardest, the first 20 feet. That's where they're making sure that there's this 2 feet on each side shoulder. That has to do with, so where, like, the planting of some of the trees, the kind of the example we ran into on North Mill Street, if you get big trees into that beginning shoulder as you're swinging it, my bumpers, even if on the sweat path analysis, the tires might get it, the bumpers aren't clearing. So that's where that first 20 feet is pretty critical.
You kind of just explained F. Could you go back to D and E, please?
Sure.
Thanks.
All right. D is provisions to permit turnarounds of the design vehicles. So once a vehicle gets in a certain distance, the challenge is either to back it out or have some type of a transition to turn around. The distance of 100 feet was common. The standard that we came from had 150 feet, and I haven't found any, like, real common language there. The idea is you get a vehicle in so far, do you make a transition area to turn around? So generally, like for a legacy, we use hammerheads in some of the areas. It's instead of a straight dead end where you have to require everybody to back out.
They put turnarounds?
You put some type of either a hammerhead or a turnaround or something like that.
That's on the road. And you're talking about
South has a hammerhead.
Drive,
yeah. Yeah, those are on a road, right.
That's what the house would be.
Right. Yep. So that does D. You ready for E?
Mm-hmm.
One passing turnaround every 120 feet. So this is the kind of the compromise piece for, you have a 12-foot driveway, every 120 feet of distance, you build in this wider area where we could either park a vehicle off to the side, where in the length of the hose, if that's where we needed to pump a hose line in a longer driveway, you can set the pump there and still get the vehicle by to go in the next piece of equipment. Sudbury just recently had a fire that got a lot of news up on a hill, long lay of supply line. One of their difficulties was trying to set a pump in the middle of all that. You lay, say this driveway is 500, 600, 700 feet, that would give me, 3-4 bump outs where I could possibly set up some of this or park some equipment in a longer driveway. That's what you're trying to accomplish.
And is this pretty common language? Standard.
It's what I've found starting to look so far. This came out of Stowe with some of the work they were doing. They started off with most of it was designed in common driveways, and now they're all, since this 1 and 2 family got repealed, they're all saying, what do we do for single family homes now to have some solution? I just worked with Stowe and Western so far. They're both using similar stuff. Western, I just got off with them last week. They did a whole series of transitions. Once you go 100 feet, you go to 14 feet. Once you go another distance, you go to 16 feet. And they just started, the longer you go, they require more width. Again, there's not perfect science to it. It all is coming backwards from this 20-foot utopic solution. So I'm open for some suggestions on language. Again, I'd like it to, the end game is that I can get access to the house.
And Zach modeled this on our common driveway by law as well, so they were looking at that.
All right, so H.
G, please.
G, what are they? Minimum depth of gravel, that is something, where do we draw that, 8 inches of gravel?
I think that's from the common driveway.
Common,
that we
yeah, had. That we had some past language.
Should this, are you talking about in place of an asphalt driveway?
I think this is underneath the...
I think there's a recognition that it might be paved, it might not be, so between G and H, so you have to have 8 inches of gravel regardless, and then if you pave it, you have to have 4 inches of pavement.
Okay.
Yeah, but we have roads that only have 1.5 inches overlay on.
Of pavement?
Yeah.
I think it's 4 total. On streets, it's 4 total. 2.5.
Sewer commissioner, every sewer that we did, we only put 1.5 inches back.
Oh. The subdivision rules require 2.5 base and 1.5 top.
Yeah, but I mean, I.
Through the chair, I agree with Ken. Maybe these G and H should match more.
I think you got to really look at this a lot more carefully and try to get it down to the minimal. I mean, you might destroy the driveway going in, and I have no problem with that. You come up my driveway, I don't have you know, the cement trucks kind of move it around when I've done some construction around the house, but you know, that's okay. I don't have a problem with it. The road doesn't have to be passable after you get your vehicle out, mm-hmm. because it was an emergency that got you, that you know, you came visiting, and please do, but 4 inches of pavement, I don't think anyone gets 4 inches of driveway pavement.
Should there be more of a generic, just say the driveway should be either paved or gravel?
So I'm not, kind of understand the birth of this. The idea, the standard that it came from, it said that you're just able to demonstrate that it is able to sustain the load of our vehicles.
Right.
So whether you made it, and again, I looked at the language from the highway department, and they used, you know, 2.5 to 3 inches mm-hmm. for their entrance for the part that they control. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, and I ran into this even when we were working on the Muse project, I talked to several of the engineers. It's trying to get an engineer that will say that the rain is the road can sustain the load of our vehicles. When you put a binder coat down, that's when they're all become braver and they all say that will sustain, they'll sign off and say it'll sustain the load of a vehicle, especially when we're protecting something like Muse. I was really working on them because I was very nervous that if my first vehicle goes into Muse
right.
and it buries itself, I'm not going to protect anything. It's done. The party's over. And that's the problem, is where that line is. The language from where this code came from talks about permeable surfaces, and I don't mind the surface as long as an engineer can say that it can sustain the load. What I'm honestly want you to really think deep into is these longer driveways. If we get to one of them, it's a permeable surface, and it's March, and my first vehicle sinks in the entrance. You're done.
Mm-hmm.
And if there is a life safety issue, we're going to hear a lot of negative feedback. The houses that I, the fires that I had, access on Piazza Lane, the driveway on Hayden Row, were issues. My third fire was Pine. What's that off of North Mill? Pine Tree Lane. Same was Clarence. There were two permeable surfaces. And the ladder truck that was there set up on Pine Tree, and after a little bit of time, it starts to sink into the driveway. It wouldn't sustain, kind of. So that's one of the problems when you have these. And again, it's a 30-year-old driveway. So what we're saying is the new ones that get installed, that's what we're dealing with, that we build them so that we can, they're maintained and they can handle this weather part to it. So, you know, I'm open for the pushback on it, but somehow at the end of the day, the expectation for the person buying the home is that the driveway will handle the load of the fire vehicle going in.
Or the expectation should be such that the fire truck can get in and can get out, and whatever the parking lot, whatever the asphalt looks like at the end of the day, who cares?
You don't want it that the asphalt's going to cave in on the vehicle, because you can really get yourself into some problems there. We can lose a piece of equipment for a while if it's buried into it. So it's a fine line. That's where you want to get somebody to say it can handle the load.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying. That's your objective.
So you're more concerned about the surface versus the type of material. It doesn't have to be asphalt.
What I ran into, so I went 10 months where they left the decision to me to accept whether the road could handle it. And I said, I don't know how to do that. I'm calling every engineer I could. I went to almost every engineer in town. The Muse was the one where they had Sampson, I think. So I was able to talk to engineers, and we all came up with a decision was this is where we could depend on the roadway, where we could all nod, okay. So it's a challenge for residents, but it is a...
And that decision ended up being Binder Cove's?
Binder was where everybody said that's where you could guarantee that it could handle the loads. And again, there was quite the exposure there.
I mean, Legacy Farm South has had Binder for the last 5 years, and, you know, it's broken up in parts, but...
Right.
But it's Binder.
Yep.
And they're running rock trucks over.
Right.
Yeah.
Elaine or Ken, whoever knows it best, and Frank mentioned it before, our driveway standards now, do they not meet our needs?
There aren't any standards beyond the first 20 feet or so.
There's nothing.
There's nothing.
That was a surprise to me.
Because this is an additional section in addition to what we currently have, right?
Yeah.
And there's nothing in there about the driveway?
No.
Yeah.
To that point, through the chair, Elaine, you mentioned bylaw or policy for street construction, and what is, Ken actually asked you a question. You answered 2 inches of gravel and 2 inches of asphalt?
No, it's a subdivision regulation. So when you're building a street, it's the gravel, which I've forgotten the depth, but then it's 2.5 inches of binder course and 1.5 of top coat for 4 inches of pavement on a street.
I mean, the gravel's the most important thing when you really get right down to it. The binder is there just so that you can sweep it and you can
plow it
and things like
that. The binder saves us for that March day, and even on a construction site. I worked construction for a couple of years before I went here. Most of the time, the gravel's fine, but sometimes it's not. And I was just down the new school there a month ago, and they were doing great in their piece. But there was a point where you lose it if it's that type of weather at a certain
Through the chair, point, the rest of the question is the gravel of 8 inches in addition to the 4 inches of pavement, which is 2.5 inches of binder and 1.5 inches of top, is that how it works? Or my driveway is a couple inches of asphalt and probably dirt underneath it.
I would hope that whoever built your driveway scraped all the subsoil away.
Sure.
Anything with organics in it.
Right, so it doesn't wash away and get home.
Well, no, because otherwise you'll go sinking like a rock. Yep. So I've been on in your driveway, I think, once or twice, and I'm sure they pretty well scraped all the stuff out of there. But how much they put back in is the other question, and what they put in. But it's you've got to get rid of all the stuff that you want to use in your garden.
I don't think it's 8 inches of gravel.
I doubt very much whether anyone's driveway, unless you really are fussy at it, I would see that would get... I don't think there's an inspection on it for sure, so I would imagine everyone cheats on that one.
And these are only the really long... These are the ones that are 100 feet or more back.
Yeah.
So it's not the short driveways.
I would suggest you take... I think you're going to get killed at town meeting just by all the amateur civil engineers that don't want to spend the money. I mean,
So I think the thing...
Pare it down to the apps, even...
Sure. Let me give you an example of language. I'm kind of curious if this... So one of the pieces that came out of the last one talked about permeable drivable surface shall be designed and maintained to support... impose loads of fire apparatus. So that's generic language. It allows the engineer to decide. It used to just let me take the letters. I had driveways in this time period where I had one down off of Christian Way where DeCarlo's gave me a detailed description of the construction of the driveway, and I just went and looked, and it looks structurally sound. They put a base coat over it. It's crowned. In that code, they were just responsible to maintain it, and I felt we're in a good place. It had water hydrants nearby, so my fire protection problem wasn't as bad, and that's your perfect scenario. You're going to have a lot of lots coming up in driveways in the next 10, 15 years as you get into more challenging lots left to develop where they may not have town water close, they may not have, they may be crossing wetlands or areas that are more challenging, and you need something in place or I'm going to have trouble accessing them.
So, to the chair, I mean, I don't want to
upset you because you've done a lot of hard work on this, but I think you should be more receptive to what the board's saying instead of being in explanation kind of mode.
Okay.
Making that point. And the second point I wanted to make is I don't think D and E are needed. I don't see a need for that. And maybe you can correct me how that would work if they weren't there, because if you just had a long driveway that was solid with no turnouts, couldn't you just back the vehicle out when you were done? I mean, is that really? Because I see people saying, wow, that's going to be a big expense when I'm putting in a driveway to put up and turn out. So I wanted to get some feedback from you on that.
No, great point. So prioritizing everything kind of my first problem is just being able to make the swing into the driveway.
Right, right.
That's kind of the priority. Mm-hmm. And in the whole scheme of things, the turnaround at the end is probably the lowest in the priority. I can back a vehicle out. It was in the old code. There is a recognized need, but in the scale of the need, that would be the lower end.
Including a ladder truck?
Yeah, and again, when you go to back the longer bigger vehicles, narrows, longer driveways, it becomes more challenging. In the priority, that would be the first one that you would say, not a big deal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So would both of those fall in that category? Or?
So the turnout one, you start to lose the whole idea of why would you have a wider driveway or not. So I working with Stowe a little bit and asking how they went through some of their problems, that they had a little more practice on some of these longer driveways, and they found that was the better compromise to have some way, because they're literally dealing with driveways in the 1,000-foot range at this point.
Sure.
And if you don't have that when you're when you are depending on the 12-foot the whole way, there is no room for pull-off, especially in the winter or as things narrow. You need some type of room when you have these bigger events to get in there. So, you know, again, if on all of them, if I lost it, I lose it. You know, the priority-wise, that one does have some meat to it, having that ability on longer driveways. I'm not sure where you might say to me, we're not going to vote on driveways like that, and I might not realize it, and I'd say no problem then. But
to your point about winter, isn't there a risk that you put the turnouts there, but they don't plow it, right? So
sure, yeah, and that's one of the things, too, like pavement, when you get to dirt and how wide you go on some of the stuff that's, they talked about that a lot. People tend to plow the paved part, and so.
Well, we typically, you know, if we're not in the driveway permit-based business as a planning board, per se, I mean, we might recognize that somebody configures a lot looking like that, and the only upland is over here. I mean, you know, you might realize where we're going to go to, but on single-family houses, if anyone becomes closer to that, it'd be conservation if they, you know, they're worried about crossing a wetland to get there. But, I mean, at this point, it's kind of, I guess nobody regulates it at all, but whether we, I think you got to pare it down a lot more, I mean, just to get it passed.
Because you could always build off of it you could, the next year, right, if you get to your point, if you get the basic stuff.
You can, you know, the depth and whatever. And
the entrance.
I mean, but I also, the wording on the first paragraph, the radius of the driveway shall be sufficient to allow the design vehicle to enter and negotiate every curve, or that the building is suppressed.
Mm-hmm.
So you're kind of putting the local code back into what they appeal, what they repealed at the state level, kind of.
The repeal is going to be like subjective on whatever they repealed it on. They didn't really have a statement other than because there was so many elements of it. There's width of the road. There's the sprinkler aspect is an option. So you kind of say to them, if somebody has an example that they run into a problem where they can't make the driveway meet some of that, you have an alternative.
Well, maybe you need to kind of put that 13D sprinkler system as like the state did it. I mean,
sure.
But you know, as it, you know, you either meet this and save your life, probably, and the rest of it might go burn away, but that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Or you build a driveway that looks like this, and everyone's going to end up sprinklering it.
That's a good point. That's not really called out, because really B through H should have that same or in it, right? Or the or sprinkler.
Yeah, that's
each of these, or sprinkler, or sprinkler, or sprinkler.
I think Zach felt that the B and beyond were more construction standards, regardless of whether it's sprinkled or not. They thought that some basic construction standards were important.
Well, let me put it this way. If I sprinkled the house because I didn't want to do A, the width and everything else for beyond doesn't make any sense, because I can't get the truck through the entryway.
Sure.
David.
I'd like to pose a hypothetical question.
Okay.
Town right-of-way, 1,000-foot driveway on that right-of-way, where the lot has no frontage, but that right-of-way creates the frontage, bounded by stone walls on each side, 20 feet wide, where the frontage of the house lot would have a circular driveway. How would this bylaw affect that kind of a situation? I have a specific in mind.
You'd have
but
to.
But I'm making this a hypothetical.
Hypothetically, error 120 feet, you'd have to make a bump out, I think.
And you would demonstrate.
That's what I'm saying, stone walls on both sides.
Well, 20 feet, though.
That gives you 8 feet. It's going to take them off.
And there are trees. Well, the trees you have to wind around and on this 1,000-foot driveway.
No, with the 20 feet, you're okay.
Yeah, it's 18 feet.
It's 18 feet.
Right, in the bump
20
out.
20 feet, you just have a bump out. But
the sweat path analysis shows that the stone walls would allow us. We went to Greyhound and Friends last week for a report of a fire. So it's coming off of Saddle Hill Road, snowbanks. It was 16 feet, 4 inches width on the pillars. And my clearance was 1 inch on each side on the ladder truck. It made it. I couldn't believe it made it. But it gave me my first idea of what the potential was. So as long as in the analysis it shows it can make the swing, I need more than 1 inch clearance, though. That is like...
Let me make it a little
stress
less
level.
Yeah,
high.
The stress level was horrific. It was some slippage, and I was...
If I may, Mr. Chairman, sure, let me make it a little more not hypothetical.
Okay.
Old Hopkinton Road, off of Winter and Pond.
Yep. Know the place.
Okay.
Yep.
There's presently a paved area 300 feet up.
Right.
It could be accessed off of Pond around the stone pillar and directly into that street, or right of way at the moment. And then there would be 1,000, there's presently paved 300 feet up the
there's one guy
old Hopkinton Road.
One guy thinks he's got a driveway there.
There are two that think they have driveways.
Okay.
There are two houses that come off it, 191 and 193.
Okay.
Wanting to pave another 700 feet.
It would have to be brought up to subdivision road standards.
It's not a subdivision.
Doesn't matter. It's an extension on an old paved road.
Paper street.
But it's a town way. It's town right of way.
Doesn't matter. It has to be brought up to standards.
And it has to come before this board.
Yes. And we have to impose the best standards that can be done on that road. We've had two or three of those
down to 12 feet, 12 or 13 feet.
To the best standards possible, I believe.
What does that mean?
Apply as much of the standards as you can.
Apply as much of the standards. Yeah, that's what the town council
says. In other words, ask for waivers.
Well, they get some, potentially. But
well, you don't need a waiver. You can only apply, because it's an ancient way of
well,
some
it's
sort.
An ancient cart path,
you can only apply
right.
the standards that you can.
Yeah. And the owners of the far lots have been before us, too, talking about it one time or another.
Well, this may come up again.
Yeah, okay. But basically, I think some people determined that the value of the roadway improvements would be probably far outweigh the value of those last couple of lots.
Well, it depends upon how much money you got, kid.
I understand that. Yeah.
And what you're willing to do.
Yep. So, okay. I don't know. Where are we, guys? gals.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
Where
you,
are
Chief.
We?
Are we?
I think beyond C is an issue.
There was another on the next sheet. There was one more.
I have a question though. Do we have the ability to recommend to move to an article forward? Do we have an ability to like change like 8 inches of gravel to another number, or is that?
Well, first of all, I think we've got the chief can sponsor this all by himself, real easy. And whether this board wants to get into the pit with him at this point.
So my answer was, if it's your article, you could do what you want with
that's
it.
Correct.
But if it's someone else's article, you can't.
You can only influence
that's right.
them.
Yeah. Right.
Because my opinion is kind of like David's is I support most of all of this, except I do have a couple questions about D, G, and H. And the type of thing that does come up at the town meeting floor, where the more variables are, the more people are out to debate them.
So, I think for D, G, and H, we tried to grab some common language. I'm open for general language. The dilemma with not looking at any of them is that there is an access issue. And I know you can just say, okay, put it off to another year, but I'm just trying to deliver the message that there's an access issue. So I don't know how to stop that message.
I think the probably the wording, if you don't mind me saying so, Ken, is that this is for a driveway over 100 feet or more. So it basically is a street, and it often can be over wetlands. It can often be tricky and hard to maneuver around. I'm thinking of some of the homes along Pond Street, along my street, well, I don't know about really long ones, but it's basically a street has to be built to get to the home, and the street has to be able to support the fire trucks. I'm just a little bit confused about, especially for G&H, about why the requirements are more stricter than, say, for an entire subdivision, where it's getting lots of traffic from lots of people all the time, to one driveway where one family's driving on it.
The intent would not to be make them more restrictive. So you could adjust that however you want. I don't have the expertise on it. Again, we just grab some
stricter.
Common. We just grab some common language. The intent is just like those to have them be able to handle the vehicle.
Sure.
So that's the intent.
Let's take it back to step one. Do the board members want to co-sponsor with the chief a article bylaw construction standards?
We do, but it depends on the final, what this says, right? Because I wouldn't support this like it is now.
Well, I think you're going to get killed with the way it is
right
now. I mean, I just don't think there's an appetite to
I mean, what's the chief's intention? Are we trying to, get to a point where we can all support
this,
right?
We all like the chief, and so we're trying to help along, and I don't mind doing
the
that.
The last thing we want is for his trucks to get stuck in some long driveway.
Yep.
So we ran into the example I'm trying to work back from in my mind is like there was a road like Cold Spring Brook Road. We went down there with the fire truck. The fire truck can't go in the driveway. They made a windy driveway. It won't go in. So the expectation for them is that it will be able to make it in. I think I don't know how to undo that expectation. If we could say to somebody, okay, we'll just do the best we can from the road, but they're not going to buy that. So that's kind of why we're stuck here. There's a lot of other driveways in town that would be a challenge for us. I just had kind of mentioned a couple to you. If somebody puts a gate up and there's no lock, you know, there was an excavator in front of a house in Hayden Road. Those things happen, but here we're just... The first step is driveway construction. I know it's challenging,
maybe
I appreciate
it. maybe the expectation is that Hook and Ladder doesn't go down the driveway.
Sure.
And, you know, you get your tanker or whatever, the pumper in there, and you get me out.
Sure.
And then whatever else happens is all good news.
So the dilemma is, and I'm going to, this is not to sound sour, but you're also committing some firefighters. So if the ladder doesn't get there or the tanker doesn't get in there with water, they're trying to put the fire out, and you're putting them on the spot to some, and it's just, that's not anecdotal. It's truly their mission is to kind of go in and try to protect property too. So I get this is challenging. I'm open for digestion of some stuff. If we put some of this stuff off or you're just not interested in it, the public still kind of has to get the message that they're building driveways that public safety can't access. They got to decide whether that's okay or not.
Would you guys be okay with what Ken and I were saying about the sprinkler being attached to each one of these? Like, as an out, right?
Absolutely. I get nervous about the sprinkler because people think I'm trying to, you know, I was debating having no sprinkler thing. It's just an alternative. The code where this came from, the alternative the whole time was, or you just sprinkler the house somehow, and they had certain pieces that was...
But to Lane's point, they were trying to
I'm not seeing, and we got about 20 minutes before we're, this evening is pretty well going to go, and mm-hmm. a couple other things I want to get to. I'm not seeing the current language. People are going rah, rah, rah. But
what you could do, I could recommend, is have the chief submit this to the warrant, then he could tweak the language, and then the board could look at it when it's finalized and then make a recommendation on town meeting floor whether or not the board voted as a board to recommend the... So you're not necessarily sponsoring the article, that would come from the chief, but you're then making a statement at town sure. meeting that, you know, we as a board, you support the way it's written now.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a good
idea. And it also makes it a lot easier for you to sponsor it because you can play with the words all through March or whatever the selectmen are going to let you play with them
sure.
without having to convene all nine of us together.
Yeah, I mean, you got some information from them now. You can go back and think about that.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
And just to clarify, it seems like the issues that we're having are on 2D, 2G, and 2H. The other ones, it didn't seem that there's a lot of concern with.
Okay. Sure. Provided there's the exception that none of that applies, none of those other ones apply if you have a sprinkler.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Yep.
So
okay.
Right.
Yeah. Or what about, you know, a pared down article where it's, you know, A, B, and C.
Yeah.
And then the right. the language that you read about the surface being. To be able to
right.
support the load,
right.
and then so you meet those, mm-hmm. or you have the sprinkler system.
I'd be good with that.
Yeah,
but
that'd be
yeah.
That's easy, and believe it or not, that's real easy for me. That meets my needs, I can tell you right now. So
yeah.
you're already. I appreciate that input.
Yeah.
And what about
yes.
I okay. It's just trimming trees, right?
I can see somebody having an issue. So I'm going to have a branch
well,
hanging
you know
down.
Those
what
branches
you know,
are coming
so.
Down if the truck goes through.
Mm-hmm.
As long as
and
it's less than about 3 or 4 inches.
The truck. So I agree. I'm
just
all
put in there that they'd be responsible for damage to the truck.
We can, and I like the talk on I guess the example I ran into, and it was a surprise to me, was like going down Piazza Lane. Was there was some a lot of white pines there, and it's on state land, but it's a challenge. Like the tanker. There's no mm-hmm. water there.
Yep.
So I'm just trying to bring the story to you, and
yep.
I'm not sure
yep.
if it doesn't get there, it doesn't get there.
Okay.
Brian's point.
Okay.
You know that trees are right behind animals and young children in terms of...
Understood. Nope.
Would it be through the chair,
yeah.
would it be safe to say it might be a good idea just to change the language that if you have a 100-foot driveway, you must have a sprinkler system, and then these items...
I'll get killed on a sprinkler system.
I don't know if that's legal either.
Let's let the chief worry about it at this point,
yep.
and we'll try to finish up in the next 15 minutes.
Thank you very much for your points.
And did you want to keep with the dual less than 100 feet and more than 100 feet?
I think
that helps too, because a lot of that quickly gets people out of
mentally they check out.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
I have a question for the chair.
Yeah, sure.
Should we? At this point, recommend or do we?
No. we'll see what his final word is, and we'll put it on another meeting between now and then. And we'll
take section at this point.
Yeah.
So he would submit the article.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Quick response. But Frank made one point. I didn't want to interrupt him.
Sure.
But
thank you.
I don't think 100 feet is as far as you think, because it's if you think about. Some of the driveways, and 100 feet is not very far.
Mm-hmm. Well, our zoning has a 60-foot setback in the agricultural district, so everyone's driveway is at least 60 feet.
Yep.
And that was one of the things that Zach considered. Well, they wanted to make an opportunity for everybody to be able to get the minimum driveway standard. So, and then if you went beyond, it was kind of your choice.
Yep. Okay, let's talk about Cobbler's Way.
Thank you very much.
You.
Appreciate it.
A lot of hard work.
Thank you, Chief.
Lane, for just a second,
okay.
if you could. Sorry that we're taking all your time. We have street acceptances already, right?
Yes, we've already voted on several.
And cobblers, we voted, we did not...
You didn't talk about it at all, apparently, last time.
It's okay. Not ready, right?
According to... It has no binder, it has binder, but no finish on it.
No sidewalks, I thought, too, right?
The sidewalks on cobbler, we started off with these stone paths, and we're not sure. We gave them an option, I think it was.
Yeah, and that didn't serve up. So he still has to do sidewalks.
He's going to have to do something.
Yeah. And then landscaping needs to be completed, and he still needs to deed the open space to Halt. And Dave Goldman was trying to stick around for that discussion, but
okay. I don't think he's going to be ready. I just, even though it's been a really mild winter at this point, and it's getting warm, but if he wasn't going to put some asphalt down, and I don't think the asphalt plants have opened back up yet.
The DPW typically does their inspections in March.
Yeah.
So,
I think it's off a year at this point to me. I mean,
told them I would bring it to the board and let them decide.
So I would agree.
It's your choice.
I mean, I just don't think we're going to get through the hoops to get there.
He also has the option of submitting his own petition to town meeting as well.
And let's let him, do that. Okay.
And we can speak against it as individual citizens, right?
Whatever. Let me skip over the master plan update because I'm conscious of time. Legacy Farms Road North update. We have a date for the ribbon cutting, which is now...
March 21st, I believe. Tuesday, right?
Tuesday, I believe, March 20 what? First?
I believe so. Double check that.
First day of spring.
And we've got
Tuesday the 21st.
A deputy secretary and assistant secretary coming out of Boston for us. And
what time?
I think we'll probably think of, well.
We didn't pick a time.
We'll see whether
morning or afternoon.
We're probably going to do morning at like 9 o'clock or something like that, maybe.
Is it a weekday or a weekend?
It's Tuesday.
It's a Tuesday. Or maybe 9:30 might be better for the people from Boston.
Avoid rush hour.
Avoid rush hour.
Well,
so
it's a reverse commute.
Coming out, it's not as bad as going.
There's no rush going west.
Well, we don't know where they're coming from.
We don't know. Yeah. And so that's which way we're headed for that. There is a preliminary looking like agenda that I proposed together to them. We're going to have a planning meeting very shortly.
Thursday at 2.
I don't want you all to show up because it's not a posted meeting, but we've got all the principals coming to, like Roy, et cetera, and we're going to hand out assignments and make this a nice event. It'll be kind of like a ribbon cutting for the building only. Don't be a ribbon cutting for the road.
Can we not post it and all show up? Because we don't need to be limited to
six. Do you want to show up on Thursday? Please come.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Tuesday. I'm sorry.
On the 21st? Yeah, we'll make sure that everyone can come up for that. We want everyone to be there.
In fact, there's a planning for
us. Yes. We're intending to invite past planning board members, Zach people that worked on it. I mean, we're going to invite everyone that we can. I mean, it's kind of a big deal for us.
It's a big project.
A lot of people and a lot of town hall staff work very hard on it, too. I mean, a lot of people worked hard on this. So we're trying to make it a celebration of public-private partnership.
Maybe we should close town hall that day and have a holiday.
Well,
let's have a parade, too.
It'll be a holiday.
Legacy Farm Road Day.
Yeah.
Yep.
Fireworks and a gas tank.
Okay.
Where will people park? I guess we'll discuss that.
We're going to figure that out.
Let's do it on the marathon day.
Yeah. Let's see. Master plan implementation. I know I went to the school committee. They had one word change. We got to get it. It's pre-K to 12 in the draft words, and they came up with their annually or whatever. We're getting selectmen are talking about it tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
So selectmen get theirs. We're in pretty good shape. A lot of the other committees are going. Maybe, Jen, you can follow up on Parks and Rec, see if they've
done. Yeah, you had met with them, right?
I met with them, and everything sounded good, but, you know, they need to make sure that we want to get this thing finalized and done with, you know, put a bow on it. But everyone seems to be...
Open Space is meeting next week, so we'll talk about that.
Good.
Historical also.
Yeah, so we'll try to finish all that up. And it's coming along pretty good, and most of
So the ones that have already given us stuff, do you want me to add that, what they've given us, into
the matrix?
The document?
Into the matrix, sure.
Yes, okay.
And then there was a question from Cindy, I think it was, that was still more on the verge of maybe we need a goal to work harder on dial-up service.
That's what she said.
That's kind of what she said. Maybe we can add that as another goal. Does the people have a problem with that?
That's fair.
As long as we assign it to them.
I was kind of thinking of Uber or some sort of thing. I mean, is that the same? Or?
Well, what they're looking for is a dial-up service for that's really cheap.
And for the disabled.
Yes. But I thought the disabled had that through our regional tent. I thought there was a drive. I thought, what's his name from Framingham, RTA had a
they
dial-up.
They do have something.
I've seen dial-up vehicles from them. Okay, goals update. I think we've just about had it tonight. I don't know.
Yeah.
Does anyone have anything more for that they wanted to talk about? Correspondence. I think we're all set. Thank you very much, Elaine.
You're welcome.
Thanks,
up.
Elaine.
And so I think we're pretty well set. I mean, we made a lot of progress getting ready for town meeting tonight.
Kudos to the Boy Scouts for sticking through the meeting.
No kidding. Wow.
Any questions?
Yeah. Yeah. And.
Working on
while
you're here?
Yeah,
it's for a merit badge. Citizenship in the community. So.
Excellent.
Great.
Awesome.
Great.
Working on his eagle. I saw recently that we had two Eagle Scouts and both Pampeleco sons, right?
Yep.
They're not true.
And then in the past we've had government students come to these. And I think that when that Nancy Clark retired, that the program might have died on there. I don't know. But... they would come and they had to sit through like 2 hours of our meeting. The fact that you made it all the way to 10, that's very commendable.
Well, yeah, hold on.
And the other thing that
hopefully make it to school tomorrow.
Don't we're not a good excuse for not working.
Mom, make sure he does this.
Yeah.
Tomorrow's Legacy North Park or anything. You can't take it off.
Yeah. Okay. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded to adjourn. How do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Good. Motion passed.
All right. Good job, Ron.